Hello, I'm Graham, hope everyone's having a great day, and welcome to today's video, which is part 3 in the series where I've been looking at modern camera sensor technology. In today's video, we'll take a closer look at CCD sensor technology. CCD stands for charge coupled device, and you'll see shortly why it takes that name. Even though this technology has been mostly overtaken by CMOS technology, for most consumer cameras, it's still used in larger formats and some military imaging systems. We have seen how the reverse bias PN photodiode responds to light, or more specifically, photons. When photons penetrate the silicon layer of the photodiode, they release electrons and hole pairs. These are directly proportional to the amount of photons entering the pixel. Silicon needs an energy level of 1.2 electron volts to release the electrons from its atomic lattice structure. Our visible light spectrum, from blue at 420 nanometers to red at 700 nanometers, has enough energy to release the electrons. Let's take a closer look at a typical CCD structure and see how photons are captured, moved and counted to give us a digital value corresponding to the light intensity falling on each pixel of our CCD sensor array. I begin by showing you a cross-section of a typical interline CCD device. Interline CCD was the second generation of these devices, as it was designed to speed up the relatively slow process of getting the data out of the sensor. Every sensor on the array consists of a PN reverse bias photodiode, plus an additional storage element used to hold the electrons released by the photons as the exposure takes place. First generation CCDs had much larger pixels but no storage device and were extremely slow at clocking out the data. That's why the second generation or interline devices were devised. The pixel now contains the photodiode and the storage device, so the amount of real estate for silicon capture is reduced. We'll begin at the stage of the exposure after we just press the shutter button. Remember, the camera is in live view mode, showing you what the image is like on the LCD screen. But to begin our exposure sequence, the shutter has to close so the array can be reset and set down to zero voltage. So this is the stage where we're at now. We've got the shutter closed, no light is falling on the array. The exposure sequence begins and the camera opens the shutter. Light, or more specifically, photons now start to stream into the silicon structure. As the photons start to knock out the electrons on hole pairs, the electrons are held captive in an area under the electrode marked with the PN junction, and it's referred to as a potential well. The size of this well is determined by the electric field generated by a positive voltage on the electrodes above this junction. As exposure continues, more and more photons release electrons, which are captured and held in the well. If we have so much light that the well fills, then we reach saturation, and it's this saturation we see in our final image. The exposure must be sufficient to cause the well to fill, but not saturated. At the end of the camera exposure cycle, the shutter closes, and the process of shuffling these electrons out to count the number of electrons being captured by the device can begin. We can now have the first movement of electrons through the silicon material. They are shifted from the well to the storage bin by an applied positive voltage on the vertical shift register, at the same time releasing the voltage on the electrodes over the well. The electrons are piling into the bin by the positive electrical charge. This happens for every pixel in every row. Once the complete columns of rows have been shifted into the vertical shift register, the processor can begin to shift the rows for each column into the serial shift register, which is fabricated onto the end of row 0 of the device. The first clock pulse moves row 0 from every column into the serial shift register. So if our CCD array has 4 million pixels along its horizontal dimension, there are 4 million cells in the shift register. On the end of this serial shift register is our electronics, which converts the electrons captured during the exposure into an electronic voltage. The electrons are shifted into this integration amplifier, and its output voltage is directly proportional to the light which fell on the pixel, in this case row 0, column 0. The output of this emitter follower amplifier, whose gain is directly controlled by the ISO setting you have dialed in, goes to the analogue to digital converter. the digital value falls within a range of 0, which is no light, to 255, which represents the highest intensity for that pixel, be it red, green or blue. The digital value which comes out of this analog-to-digital converter is stored by the processor in a memory location corresponding to row 0, column 0. Once the memory has been filled with row 0, column 0, the zero shift register moves one place to the right, thus moving every column to the right. So in effect, we've now got column 1, row 0, ready to be presented to the amplifier and ADC. This is repeated until all the 4 million columns have been read out through the amplifier, analog to digital converter, and stored into memory. Once the complete row has been shifted out from the serial shift register, we can now repeat the process of shifting the vertical shift register down one row. So now effectively, row 1 is the row that's shifted into the serial shift register. And as before, the columns are shifted out and amplified, passed through the analog to digital converter and stored in memory. This process continues until all the rows have been shifted down to the serial shift register. So you can see this is a long process to shift out 12 million pixels on a 4 million by 300 sensor array. We said this was called a charge coupled device, and you can now see that the electrons are passed from the pixel to the storage bin and then shifted down each of the registers, either vertically or horizontally, into the amplifier and finally into the analog digital converter. So this is hence called a charge coupled device. In the early days they were called bucket brigades. Now the camera has a digital value of 0 to 255 for every pixel in the array, and it's stored in a memory location corresponding to the row and column position in the array. It's now the function of the image processing engine to begin to crunch the algorithms which determine the exact colour of every pixel by methods I discussed in part 2. So you can see it's a long process, and it's this slow speed which prevents CCDs from a higher video output than usually 720p. In a live view situation, we're still performing this serial shift register operation for every row and every column on a continuous basis. The only difference in live view mode is that we're not storing the value that's coming out the analog to digital converter in the camera memory, we're just taking the output and feeding it through a digital analog converter to display it on our LCD display. Sometimes you'll notice when you're using live view with a CCD device, if there are any very bright highlights, you'll see vertical streaking. This light leakage occurs because the light that comes in through the micro lens leaks past the photodiode and actually into the vertical shift register, and it's carried along with the actual charge from the photosite down into the serial shift register, and it becomes part of the image. So we end up with every pixel in that column being flooded by the light from the macro lens. So it appears in video and it appears on your live view mode, but because during a photographic exposure the intensity is reduced, we don't get the same amount of saturation, so we don't see this vertical streaking normally in images. Well, that's the CCD or charge coupled device. Next time I'll take a closer look at the more complicated CMOS structure and how that works. And at the same time, we'll then compare the differences between the two devices in terms of relative performance and quality of output. So, until the next time, thanks very much for watching. Again, a lot to get through this time. Thanks for your patience. If you're a newcomer to the channel and haven't already subscribed, please consider clicking the subscribe button, and then when I do upload the final part of this video, you'll see that in your subscriber list when you go to review it. So until then, thanks very much for watching, take care, and goodbye for now.